One second, get your attention.
Pehle unhe aware nahi pehle, couple of people outside.
Tell them also, anyone who comes in and who's missed 16th lunch, we'll all have here together in the hall.
It's my birthday on the 13th, so I'm giving you all a birthday treat.
Nothing scandalous, bata idhar. Sunday is 16th.
Yes, I meant which beer?
Yes, beer and lunch, of course.
Just call them, we must start. Of you who have come for the first time today, we've already had three or four sessions. Just give you a brief recap of what we have been doing. The very first day, we went into the two basic prayers, Ashayam and Yatha. And there was a general talk about the background of the religion, how it existed in the various Persian empires. So we went into a bit of history as well. And thereafter, spoke about the great chief priest of Shapur II, who lived in about 350 AD, and who compiled what is our basic Kasti prayer. And we went into the Kasti prayer itself, which is nothing but, in the first part, a compendium of two verses from the Gathas, a line from the Gathas, something else from the Vandidat, and then the Avramazda Khodai prayer, which was at that point of time in the spoken language of the day, Pahlavi, and then the confession of the faith, which is the last part. So the prayer itself, the basic prayer which Parsis are supposed to do 5 times a day, is itself in 2 or 3 languages. If you choose to look at Gathic Avestan being the equivalent of Rigvedic Sanskrit as one language and the younger Avesta as another, but certainly in 2, Pahlavi was a completely distinct language. This was on the first day. Then on the second day, I thought the best way to introduce these 217 hymns, which are contained in 17 chapters of the Yajashni, which is a book containing 72 chapters, was to read the two great sermons of Zoroaster. The smaller sermon is contained in Yasnaha 30, which is chapter number 30. And we dealt with the smaller sermon. And after the smaller sermon, the next time we dealt with the larger sermon, which is contained in 45. Now, the reason why it's called the smaller and the larger is that we are given a clue in the larger, which says that not only those who have come from close by, but those who have come from afar, please listen. And the basic point that he is making in both the sermons is that moral choice is entirely yours. There were two spirits created in the beginning of all time by God himself. The spirits were equal in every way. That's a very important point he makes. And were given moral choice. One chose correctly, one chose incorrectly. So the important point is to choose correctly. And when you choose correctly, you tread what is called the path of Asha, the path of truth. It is likened to the test of molten metal. The word used is Ayanga. And here I may digress a little, because one important point that I made qua reading the language of the Gathas is that fortunately for us, and this was discovered by a great British judge, Sir William Jones in Calcutta, that we are all part of the Indo-European group of languages. So that 20% of the words that you find in the Gathas, you will find used in modern day Gujarati, Hindi or English. So, like Nostradamus's great letter to his son Caesar, you find these quatrains all, you know, scrambled and meaningless. The only way to ultimately derive some meaning from them is to choose keywords and then work around them. Now, in his case, of course, those keywords were words of places and one or two historical figures. But here the keywords are those which you find in Gujarati, Hindi and English. So this is how and what we have been doing on the last couple of occasions. We finished the two sermons. The first sermon, as I told you, dealt with the two spirits, moral choice, the fact that they came together and created life and its destruction, opposing forces, and that ultimately it is life that will triumph in immortality and not death. And after that we spoke last time about the greater sermon, where again in verse number 2, the Holy Spirit speaks to his twin brother, because they are called twins. Yema is the word used. Maybe having something to do with Yema as well in the old Rigvedic pantheon. And they say that they are exactly twins. But one twin berated the other and said, we are completely unlike in every way. So it is very important to realize that good and evil do not mix at all. They are completely unlike each other. Our philosophies are different, our thoughts are different, our words are different, our deeds are different, our souls are different, our very being is different. Now, all this was spoken of, and the single most important verse in the entire Gathas is Yasnaha 45.8, which I had pointed out to them, which you may please turn to as a recap. 45.8, which you will find at page 236. And why is it most important? Because Zoroaster, who has been asking for communion with the Almighty, ultimately gets communion with the Almighty. And he says very clearly that now I have actually perceived God Himself, who has come to me. And when He came to me, the first thing He told me was the Holy Triad, which we believe in so strongly. Good thought, good word, good deed. So you will find this, you will find the Triad. You will find that He has trampled the path of Asha, which is the difficult path of truth, which was likened to molten metal earlier. And having perceived God, therefore now, I am about to reveal what God alone has told me. So the important point that He again makes is, all this is revelatory, it is not from His own mind. And therefore He finally says, let us lay down our devotions to God on high. On high is described by two words, each of which, fortunately for us, we can understand because they are in Gujarati as well as English. Garo Deman. Garo Gavanu Deman Domain. So with this brief recap, there was one other little thing we did before we moved on. And now after the two sermons, we are moving on subject-wise. We're not moving on verse-wise. The subject we did was God and His attributes last time. God, as you know, is Ahura Mazda. Ahura is the same Rigvedic word Asura, because Sir becomes her in our language, and it only means Lord. Mazda was coined by Zoroaster for the first time as meaning Maz, from the English word majestic, great, and Da, creator. So the Lord now, who is the great creator of everything and who pervades all life, which we found in another verse last time. Now with this brief background, may I take you to today's subject, which again is very interesting, and which is the appointment of the prophet to come down, as he himself says, as the very first Ratu stroke Soshyat. Ratu, you will remember, is the word used in the very first part of Yatha Huvarya. And Soshyant is a person who is like a savior, who comes down at difficult times and times of trouble. So we will deal in today's lecture with Zoroaster's appointment here on earth and all the verses generally which deal with him. Now the first verse, chronologically, if we move chapter-wise, please turn to, which is Yasnaha 29.8, page 111. Now, you'll remember the very first chapter of the first gatha, the Aunavaiti, is the chapter just before this, 28. 29 is the chapter which deals with a conference that took place in heaven, which conference then decided who will be appointed to look after Gauss Urvan. Now, you remember the expression Gauss Urvan basically meant the soul of every living being on earth. Gauss is the earth basically. And the earth cries out saying that there is rapine, there is anger, there is hell out here. Who are you going to send us? So the Lord appoints a committee. And the committee consists of the archangels who are Asha, which is truth, the very embodiment of truth, and Vahumana, which is the highest that the mind can attain. And the first thing the Lord tells Asha is, look, there is this terrible cry, this wail from earth. We have to send somebody down to protect it. Who do we send? So Asha gives a reply saying, yes, we need to send somebody, but he has to be extremely strong to resist what's going on. And at the moment, I don't seem to find anybody. So the Lord then turns to Vahumana. And Vahumana gives him an answer and said, yes, we have a certain person, Zoroaster, who has listened to our commands, and I think he should be sent. And this is that verse. And then, as soon as he is sent, the earth wails back and says, look, you've sent us only this cowardly little human being. The word used is pusillanimous, cowardly. What is he going to do? And then obviously comes a verse which is after his life's work, and which says, thank you very much, he has ultimately saved us. So this chapter, a very interesting chapter. And now please read about his appointment in verse number 8. It says, basically, that only one, now Vahumana is speaking, if you remember, to God, and saying, one such is known to me, who has listened to our teaching. The word sasna is teaching, word number 8. Gusta, you've already come across several times, is to hear, listen to. And he says he is Zarathustra of the Spitamma family. Spitamma obviously was some great ancestor of his. And then he says, he is a person who is willing to do God's work, and ultimately, since he has to do a great deal in terms of completely revamping things, the key word here is hudemem, which is word number 22. The idea is that his speech must be such that he is able to get through to humanity to tell them how they've been wrong. Vakshedraya is to speak. Vax. So, in short, he is being given eloquence. And that is another important point, because if you remember, even in the Kasti prayer, which is echoed in the Gathas, violence is to be completely eschewed. A snaithisha, which is a sword, is to be put into its scabbard. It is never to be used. So the important point being made here is that though there is anger, rapine, violence, he will repel it by appealing to men's reason and ultimately, hopefully, creating a new earth, a new renovation here, so to speak. And for that, we come now to verse 10. If you just move over the page and come to 113. Now this is the second last verse of this chapter, and this has to be read along with 29.1. So let's go first to 29.1, which you will find at page 104. This is the verse I've been telling you about, where Gauss Urvan, words 2 and 3 of this verse, complained to the Almighty and said, why did you create me at all Because ultimately, Aismo, which is word number 13, which is equal to wrath or anger. Aisma is wrath, anger. Hazas is rapine. And remmo is violence. So, there is rampant violence, anger, rapine going on. What are you doing about it? This threatens us all the time. Therefore, please send us somebody who will protect us. Now, the important word used here is Vastraya, word number 32. You'll remember, it occurs in the last part of Yathahuvairya. Drigubhyo dadat vastarem. Same word. So, a Vastraya basically is somebody who protects. If you remember, a Drigu was somebody who was in need. You remember the old Yathahuvairya prayer. So, the soul of Mother Earth is calling upon the Almighty to send somebody who will take care of rapine, violence, anger, and will be a general protector. Now, to this, come back to verse 10 at page 113. This is the verse of, ultimately, of acceptance, that Zoroaster now is accepted. After the previous verse, just have a glance of it, at it, where the soul of Mother Earth wails again and says, what is the point of sending somebody who, as I told you, is an Asuraya, which is somebody who is a coward. Word number 12 at 112. And what was needed was somebody strong, mighty, etc. But finally, fortunately, things have worked out well. And verse 10 tells us how they have worked out. So it says, therefore, through thy kshatra, again, last part of Yathahuvairya, word number 7, the Lord's power, grant unto Zoroaster a great mind, so that he may bring us, and these are the key words, Huzaitis and Ramam, word 13 and word 14. Word 14 means peace, it occurs in several stanzas. The word Huzaitus, please remember, whenever the word who is used, like who Urvatat, if you remember, who means good. And Saiti means abode, literally. So, Tarapurwala translates it as rest, probably taking it to mean that we will rest only if we have happy abodes to rest in. But literally speaking, it means a good abode and peace. The earth itself then becomes a good abode for all of us. And then we come to a very important declaration in the last part, which is missed in this translation completely. Azem chit ayya mazda tvam mengi pauruvim. If you remember, we've come across this word several times, vaidem. Now, pauruvim is the key word which means first. Therefore, here again, there is an allusion to Zoroaster being the first such person appointed from above to come down here and generally reveal what has not been revealed before. Now, the key word, as I told you, is the word Pauruvim, number 23. So, he comes down here not as the noblest creation. He comes down here as the very first to tell us all this. And that you find unmistakably said in two other stanzas. Please mark them here. 28.3 and 44.11, to both of which we'll go immediately. Now 28.3, you will find at page number 95, please go to it. Here, interestingly enough, the opposite of porvim is used in word number 8, apaurian. So, what he is saying here is, I am about to tell you something that has never been heard before. So, by way of contrast with porvim, he is telling you very clearly, not only am I the first in that verse, which comes in the other verse as well, but I am going to tell you something which you have never heard before. And this becomes explicit in the question chapter, if you remember, chapter 44, which begins with spentam. If you remember, the opening words of each is exactly the same. And verse number 16 is the second part of the Kemna Mazda prayer. So if you go to the verse chapter or the question chapter, which begins, if you remember, with Tattva Perasa Eres My Vauchaura, which contains the English word eres, erect, straight. And now go to 44.11. Which you will find at 219. Again you use the word pauruyo, word number 21, please mark it. So the important line is line number 4, azem toi ais pauruyo frovoi vide, which basically means that for this task, that is the task of imparting a revelation given from outside, I have been sent as the first. Pauruyo frovoi vide. Frovoi vide is been sent. Pauruyo again is first. Please mark both words. And if you remember, Zoroaster describes himself, and these are all little clues that come out to us, as a Zautar, which is literally like an Agnihotri in the old faith, which is the Rigvedic religion. And what he is doing here is bringing about a complete reform, throwing over everything that existed, replacing it with one God, who is the be-all and end-all of everything, and then telling us that what I am telling you is only what he has told me, which are in the nature of eternal truths. And because they are in the nature of eternal truths, what was said anywhere from 3,000 to, God alone knows, 8,000 years ago, are all completely relevant when it comes to living today. Now, we come back, therefore, to verse number 31.2 to move on to Zoroaster's appointment as a Ratu. Now, if you remember, 31.2 at page 127. Now, if you remember, a Ratu is somebody, first part of Yathavarya, who has trodden down the path of truth. Asada Chithacha. Correct? So, he tells us in unmistakable terms, because you people have not been instructed correctly how to choose correctly. I have been appointed to be your teacher, to be your Ratu. And most importantly, he has been sent amidst two groups. Now, it is important that the whole of the people he addressed, whether from near or from afar, were put again, polarized into two groups. The message, therefore, is a message which is universal in nature. And these verses also we will come to immediately. So the idea is, in this verse, that because of worldly lures, he puts it very well, moral choice is not clear. You don't see it clearly. The word deresta is insight. IB is clear. Word number 6, word number 7. Therefore have I come to all of you. The word vispeng is important. Number 11. I have been sent down to say this to all of you. And word 14 is the word Ratu. Clear? Then he says, that is why now I have come amidst both groups, so that we may live in accordance with truth. Now this part again is very important, because his message was not a tribal message. His message appealed to mankind as a whole. And this again becomes important from three other verses which I'll give you immediately. First turn to 28.5, which you will find at page 97. Page 97. And here the key words are in the last two lines. Ana, mantra, mantra, the word mantra used today. Majistem, you've already seen. Mazda, majistem, great, majestic, big. In this context, it is excellent. So through the hymns that I speak, I will teach, and then the next three words are very important. Vavroi Maidi, it is really two words. Maidi comes from man again. Vavroi is moral choice. Srastra is those who have gone astray, those who are wicked. And Hizva is by tongue, literally. So therefore, the method of preaching is through mantras of the most excellent kind, so that those who have gone astray may choose aright. You'll find the same thing echoed in chapter 31, verse 3, at page 128. And the key words used are almost the same. Hizva, tongue, Vauraya, Vauro Maidi, choose. It's important that you get conceptually what he's trying to say through the Avestan word. Therefore, 31.3, last two lines. Everybody got it at page 128. Hizva, same, by tongue. Thvaya, Anho. Anho is mouth. Thvaya is your. So, your. So it's very important. Your mouth, not my mouth. Please put off phones if you don't mind. Through your mouth, all right? So that those who live, Jvanto, Jivano, same thing. Jvanto is all those who are living. Jvanto. Again, you use the word vispeng, very important, underline it. All. So, all those who are living should choose correctly, Vauraya. Yes.
Very widely.
No, it is not convert at all. Vauraya means moral choice. That is precisely why I want you to understand what the Avestan word is. And it occurs throughout. So that it's unmistakably the faculty of choice. That's why the Avestan words are very, very important in this context. And they are used repeatedly, as you've noticed. The key words are used repeatedly. Hizva, by tongue. Naturally, convert only means correct moral choice, nothing more, nothing less. Vauraya. And the expression is all, whispering, very important. Therefore, the message is universal. Whispering, again repeatedly used. Now with this we come back to where we stopped at verse 31.2. If you remember, we digressed into several things. There's one more verse I have to show you before we come back, which is 46.12 along these lines at page 251. Which also points to the fact that this was meant to be a universal message for mankind. Because very clearly the key words here used are word 8 and word 11. Now word number 8 specifically states that number 11, which is a man called Phrayanna, happens to be a Turanian, Turaya. So whatever Turanian may mean, Toynbee says that they were Mongols. Mongols. He was certainly not Iranian, whatever else he was. So, what is important here is that Phrayanna himself, who is one, perhaps one of the chiefs of the Mongol clans, because they speak of him as a person who was a very powerful person. And the important point that is being made here is, the message has gone even to him. And he in turn will unite everybody together in making the correct moral choice. It fits in because, don't forget, who wailed for Zarathustra? The entire earth. Gausurvan wailed. A section didn't wail. So he's come as somebody to put back everything on the rails for the entire earth, or whatever the known world at that point of time was. And the idea was that not only was it meant to be confined to the people who happened to be born in, but people who have come from afar, as you saw in the Great Sermon, and now unmistakably people of other places as well, a Mongol. Sorry? Yes, naturally, because he's now got the message. And being one of the chiefs, he in turn will impart it to his people. So, this again, this verse is very important, not only from the point of view of his appointment and what he is preaching, but also from the point of view of the universality of the message given. And one other interesting verse here shows you Zoroaster's humility, because he refers to himself here as a Ratu, not a Soshyant. The higher grade is somebody who is a Soshyant, if you remember. Soshyant is an actual savior, person who comes to redeem mankind. Now in 48.9, you will find the word Soshyant used so far as he is concerned. Page 273. It's an interesting verse, because he's asking that, look, I am supposed to be your savior on earth. You'll find the word Sosios used, word number 19. Now, please tell me whether I am able to tell mankind that you, O Lord, rule over all of us. And that someday, even those persons will be told what is correct. Even those who menace us, so to speak. So interestingly enough, the prophet is referred to by two words. Ratu, when he speaks of himself, with the greatest humility, and then in this verse where he is referred to as a social. Now come back to, because this one verse, if you notice, has taken us all over the place. Only to recap, first very important point is, why has he been appointed? Because persons have made the wrong moral choice. Which persons? All persons. Vispeng. All. All humans. Persons are divided only into two groups according to moral choice. And ultimately the idea is to bring over everybody so that they make it easier for themselves. Because unless you do something morally correct just now and continue to do it, you are going to face it when you die. So why not do it just now? Far simpler to do it just now and not face the tribulations that you are inevitably going to face after you die. So this verse therefore has spawned two things, if you remember. One is the word Ratu along with the word Soshyant, and the other is the universality of the message, of making the correct choice. Now we come to verse 33.6. Now if you remember, this is a verse I have already read to you. I don't know how many of you people are working. Huh? Good. Okay. And I read it with the most important. 45.8, if you remember. Correct? Now here, the important expression used is Veres Yaidyai, word number 14, Manta Man Vastraya. Again, very clear. What is Vastra? You remember? Protector, guardianship. The word Vastra goes with the word Ratu, which goes with the word Soshyant. This is the time to note all three, because they'll occur repeatedly. Manta as thought out, and veres diye, may I fulfill. So may I fulfill my guardianship as thought out or planned. Planned by who? By the Almighty in heaven. Chapter 29. Therefore, do I desire easy eye? I wish vision of thee and communion with thee, O Lord. Now this vision, perception, which is given, if you remember, through his mind's eye, chasmaini vyadaresim, in 45.8, is ultimately given to him in 45.8, which is why I told you to read them together. Now another very interesting concept comes in 33.7, where again we will have to digress. The important word here is maghavno, number 16, 1-6. The Magha Brotherhood. Alright? I'll tell you in a minute. So he says, come unto me. Again, the same thought echoed, please come unto me directly, so that I may be heard beyond the few people that I've got around me just now. Now, who were the few people that he had around with him? Interesting. For that, let us digress from this and go into the three grades of people that he had around him. Now, all the verses which have to do with the Magha Brotherhood, we'll go into just now, at this point itself, so that this, again, key concept comes across to all of you. Interestingly enough, this is perhaps some, if to use a loose expression, church or order. It's like an order. And to this order belong three grades of persons. The three grades are referred to in 32.1 at page 148. And please note each one of them. The first is Svaitus or Svaitu, word number 3, page 148. Highest grade is Svaitu. Second is Airyamna, which is number 8. And the third, Verezanam, number 6. Please note all of them. I'll tell you what each one means and how do we grade them again becomes clear only from other hymns, how I graded them rather. Svaitu is a person who is so spiritually advanced that he has become self-reliant. He has gone beyond instruction. This is the highest grade. The second is Airyamna, which literally only means friend. So, one group within this Magha Brotherhood is so spiritually evolved that they are now self-reliant. The second group, Airyamna, are persons who are supposed to be friends of the community at large. And the third group, Verezenem, are workers. Persons who are assigned tasks, basically. Obviously, the task of attempting to go and tell people what is the correct moral choice. Now, each of these formed part of the early MAGA brotherhood which Zoroaster formed around him. Because unless you have, like Christ had apostles, it's very difficult to spread the word. So these were like apostles in three groups. One, the most spiritually evolved. The second were the guys who went around telling everybody. And the third were those assigned tasks.
We don't know their identity.
No, they are groups. Now, the identity of persons mentioned in the Gathas is only Zoroaster himself, Vistasp, who was the king who he converted, very important from his point of view, because the moment you convert a ruler, the ruler gets everybody over. Phrasostra and Jamasp, who are mentioned by name, who were the Vogva brothers. They came from some family called Vogva. And they were ministers of Vistasp. So they were again big shots. They are mentioned by name. And we are told in later folklore, not here, that Havovi was their sister who Zoroaster married. And his own first cousin, somebody called Maidyomanga. And again, later folklore tells us he was perhaps the first convert, so to speak. To the new way of thinking. You'll come across all of them. This is in answer to a question, you see. Maidyomanga. M-A-I-D-Y-O. Manga. M-A-N-H-A.
Manga sounds a lot like your mega.
Yes. Maidyomanga. Now, we know that he's a cousin because he also belonged to the Spitamma clan. That much we know. Short of these, there are two other personages. And of course, Phrayana, who we've just spoken of, the Turanian. The two bad boys, in fact, there are three bad boys. One is Yima, who is none other than our great king Jamshed. Yima is equal to Jamshed. And even in the later folklore, the Khwarena, which is, you know, the royal, the right to rule, divine right to rule, went away from him in the form of a bird because he became evil later.
It's the same of the where Jamshid
sleeps. Yes, same. So this is Jamshid, no, none other than the later Jamshid, Yima. Now what was his sin, we are told in the Gathas, in verse 32.8, if you just note that here. Yes. 32.8. Yima is number 5, word number 5 of that verse. What did he do? He illumined the material welfare of the earth. It got crossed out. Material welfare. Gauss, if you remember, is earth. Baga is material. And Swaremno is to illumine. Sware itself means light, the sun. Sorry? That was bad because it took you away from the path of Asha. It took you away from the path of Asha. You have other verses also which are interesting, which tell you that those who become the word Ishwar, big shots, big lords, are liable to stray from the path of Asha because they are big shots and because they are filled with riches, material riches. Not a good thing. If you can handle it, good. If you can't handle it, don't do it. So this is one of the personages among the bad boys. The other two are some robber chieftain called Bendva by name and another one called Grehma, G-R-E-H-M-A, and we'll come across that. So this is as far as the named persons in the Gathas are concerned. You don't go beyond this. Now come back to the Maga brotherhood. If you see 29.11 now, which you will find at page 114. Zoroaster expressly exhorts the Almighty to grant recognition to this brotherhood so that they may spread the new teaching. And that you find in lines 2, or rather 3 and 4. Yuzem Mazda Fraksnane. Fraksnane is teaching. Yuzem is you, O Lord. Mazoi again, same word. Majestic, great, huge. Number 14. Maghai. So the great Maga brotherhood, please give recognition to Paiti Zanata. Zanata is recognition. Alright? Then we come to 33.3 and 4. And these are interesting verses which give you a little insight into who are these three grades within the brotherhood. 33.3 is page 166. So, you are told, makes no difference who you are, whether you are self-reliant, whether you are a friend, or whether you are somebody instructed. Whoso within them, unto those who are good, acts the best, or fosters life zealously, spreads the word zealously, shall certainly dwell with Almighty God in the fair pastures which are mental gifts of woman. Because here again you have the three mentioned, Svaitu Verezanyo Aryamna, 4, 8, 9. Similarly, in 33.4, page 167, very interestingly, this is what Zoroaster prays away, and prays will never happen to these three groups. Now what will not happen? From those who are spiritually evolved, perverse thought. Very interesting. Because you chaps are great, don't think you are great. You start thinking perversely if you lose humility. Then from those who work, because they have to actually go out and do field work, opposition of those who are your nearest kin. Naturally, if you are going to spread the word, you will get opposition from them. And then from the Airyamna, who is the friend generally of everybody, keep away those who slander them. Because they again are attempting to do good work. And those who want to fachad maro them, so to speak, will slander them. So please keep these three groups away from these horrible things. You see, pasture of the cow again means nothing, because basically gauss is not cow, as I told you. Gauss is earth, everybody on earth. And gauss urvan, who wailed, if you remember, for Zoroaster, is the earth. So what they are telling you is, everybody on earth is being kept away by the wicked. Achista is wicked, number 24. From those who are Vastarem, Vastrat, number 23, and those who are Mantum, 25. Those who are protectors, those who are herdsmen. That's the sense. And then, on a very personal note, in Yasnaha 46.1, which you will find at page 240, Zoroaster ran up, or ran aground, with a lot of trouble. And this is almost as if he had been jailed somewhere, because he says clearly, where shall I bend my steps, where do I go? And they have kept me away from my brotherhood. They kept me away from the Svaitu, the Airyamna, etc. We don't know. But we get a hint of rulers of some lands, which is 19 and 21, Daksyos' lands, and Sastaro is a ruler, 21. Drigvanto is an evil ruler. This is just before the verse, if you remember, of verse 2, which we did earlier, and which we matched with 44.18, if you remember, where material possessions were asked for, which are meaningless otherwise. Give me 10 horses, give me a mare, give me a camel. Why? Because being a man of small possessions, people don't take him seriously. That's a very human attitude. It exists everywhere. It's human. Yeah. It's in every segment of humanity. Then we come to 46.14, which refers to the king who accepted his faith. 6.14, page 253. Which refers, if you remember, to Vistasp, the king who accepted the faith. And here, what is important is, it is this king who will make this great brotherhood, the Magai, recognized and achieve renown. That's what he's saying here. So again, why these verses are being read is because they all contain the expression Magai. We had digressed, if you remember, into the order, the church, whatever you want to call it. And here he refers to Kava Vistas in words 15 and 16. Yahi again, word 17 is new age, dawn of something new.
Do we know after how many years did Zoroastra succeed in converting Vistas?
No, nothing here. But somehow or the other, A.V. Williams Jackson has written a book on Zoroastra, which he has gleaned from the oral sources and various traditions. There's a Zarathustra, which is 13th century AD, much, much later. So the oral sources seem to suggest that at age 30 he got the call. Very soon thereafter he went around preaching. By about age 40 he had converted the king. Went on like the Buddha, spreading the faith all over. And finally got murdered at age 77. But this is all later tradition, this is not something that... No, what happened to the brotherhood is only this, that it got recognized and obviously was the instrument by which the religion spread. Because we do know from the Yasna Haptangaiti, which is the Yasna of the seven, Hapt means seven, Sapt, seven chapters, which are between 34 and 43. If you remember, the Gathas begin at 28, correct? So first, Aunavaiti. That goes on till 24 or 34. From 35 to 42, you have these seven chapters, which are not Gathas. Where for the first time, you have all the divinities of the Rigveda who were thrown over by Zoroaster creeping back. So that every time the Maga brotherhood went to spread the faith somewhere or the other, the persons to whom they spread the faith must have been so strong and so entrenched that they refused to accept Ahura Mazda unless you referred back to their particular deity and took and brought him back. So the Zoroastrianization of these deities then took place. And instead of their being gods, they became angels. So this is how, for example, Mitra creeps back. Now Mitra, if you remember, is a very major asura of the Rigveda, major lord. Mitra comes back in the form of Meher Mitra, so that you have a yash to him, you have a nyas to him. And all these people then get Zoroastrianized, so to speak, by saying they are no longer gods, but that they are in the angel class below the lord, who are also worthy of worship. Yes, because you had to now. Yes. Now, something like Hom, for example, which is Som, which Indra used to drink, get drunk and then behave arbitrarily in the Rigveda, was referred to by Zoroaster as Piss, Mutar. Same Gujarati word he uses in the Gathas. And throws it over. But it became, the cult must have been so strong that at one point, not only is Om bowing to Ahura Mazda, but Ahura Mazda is also bowing to Om, which you will find in Yasna number 9, in this 72 chapter book. But this again is a general digression to tell you what happened to the Maga brotherhood after. Obviously, they didn't have either the personality or the strength of Zoroaster to continue with the throwing over of all this.
Is it?
Compromise, correct. We don't know. This is all way. You see, you are talking of somebody who lived at least 3,000 years ago. At least. He may have lived, if we are to believe the Greeks, 8,000 years ago. Because many Greeks in 300 odd BC said he lived 6,000 years before us. So we don't know. Now to come back, where was I, by the way? Which verse?
15.
Sorry? 46?
46.1.
46.1. Right. We'll move on from there now. 49.7 is the next. 9. Just complete all the verses which deal with the MAGA brotherhood and these three grades and then come back. 49.7. Here again the three grades are referred to. And why do I say I have categorized them as number 1, number 2, number 3? This verse helps. Because the last two lines show that the Airyamna who is below the Svaitu anyway, because the Svaitu is the most realized guy, are both to set examples to the Varezana who is the worker. So this only says ke Airyamna ke Svaitus data is angat. Data is a law. So how do you live in accordance with these laws? You do it by setting a good example to the person to whom you assign tasks, the Varezana. This grading, by the way, has not been done by any scholar to my knowledge. It's my own. And it's done from what I've been able to understand from these verses. Then go on to 51.11, just to complete this, so that you have it in one spot. The brotherhood now suddenly opens up. And who does it accept? It accepts any friend. Any person who lives the path of truth, who thinks aright, Armaiti, and who is devoted to Vahumana and is fundamentally clean and good may regard himself as being of the brotherhood. The brotherhood appears as Magai in word number 19. And then in 51.15, he promises everyone who belongs to the larger brotherhood, so to speak now, Garo Deman, which as I told you earlier, is the abode of song, which was first attained or which first created by God himself. The key words here are Magavabhyo, number 4. Garo Deman you will find in 7 and 8. Aura Mazda in 9 and 10. The word Pauruyo again, first in number 12. And Jasat is to go, went first. Alright? Now with this, this digression is over. And we come back to the verses which deal with Zoroaster. The verses which deal with Zoroaster. So far, the subject matter is Zoroaster. Just as last time, subject matter was Ahura Mazda. This is subject matter 2, so to speak, after the little sermon and the great sermon. And now we come to some very, very beautiful verses. Starting from Yasnaha 33.11, 11 to 14. The humility of the Prophet is astounding. You will see from verse 11 that he is actually asking the Lord to take pity on him while apportioning the reward of each one. It's an amazing verse. Ye sevisto ahurav. The word sevisto is very important. God is almighty. He is all pervading and almighty. Sevisto basically means strong. So almighty. Fradath gaitham is what advances life. Gaitha is life. Gaim, gaus, gaitha. Number 11. Fradath is to advance. And then the most beautiful words. Srauta moek, which comes from sarosh, to hear from within. Listen to me, moe is me. Merezdata moe, take pity on me. Whilst apportioning to each what is due to him. Adai kahiya chit paiti. And then verse number 12 is one of the most beautiful. It says, unfold thyself within me, O Lord. May right-mindedness, Almighty, grant me strength of character. You remember the word Tevishi, word 6. One of the four great gifts of Vahumana, if you remember. Tevishi utayuviti hu urvatat ameritat. And again, beautiful. Through the spirit which chose correctly, Spenta Mainyu. Please grant me goodness as a reward for prayer. What is the reward that you grant? That I may be good to people.
That's why the importance of prayer.
Yeah. One of the, prayer is a separate subject. I'll deal with it. There are a lot of verses on it. This is one of them. Grant me goodness as a reward for my prayer. And Asha Hazo Emavat. Emavat is full. Hazo is strength. So give me the full strength that comes having trod the path of Asha. Linked to Tevishi, strength of character. And here comes one answer to Farida. Where is love looked or spoken of? And give me the all-embracing love that Vahumana gives everyone. The word, if you remember, I told you, the word used is Feseretum. These are inspired verses. They are said by somebody who is almost in a trance. Then 13. Equally beautiful. Rafedrai does not mean that I may be blessed. Rafedrai means bliss. So give me bliss, and the second is very interesting. Make me far-seeing. What does far-seeing mean? Give me vision. Exactly. Beautiful word. Vision. And then give us the incomparable gifts in Abhifra, word 8. That really means incomparable. You can say priceless, you can say incomparable, you can say whatever. Closer, exact meaning is incomparable. And ultimately, after invoking Kshatra, Vahumana, and Almighty, make us realize our inner selves. Athas Nyas. All these three come. 12, 13 and 14 are part of the Athas Nyas. I'm sorry? Yes, is one of them. Yes. My wife's name is one of them. Sanaya, number 53. Varun is number 44. Davar, judge, is number 97.
Aura Mazda itself?
Yes, 88. Aura Mazda is 88. Anyway. Not just now. We'll, if you like, have a separate session on them. There. Athas Nyas contains 12, 13 and 14. They are bodily lifted. Athas Nyas is much, much later. By the time of the Athas Nyas, Athar has become the son of God. Athro Aure Mazdav Putra. Whereas in the Gathas, Athar is nothing except fire. And that's the question you had asked last time, that what do we do? Zoroaster has instructed you worship fire. Why do you worship fire? As an emblem of truth. So fire is worshipped in this, in the Gathas, only because it is equal to truth. Now why is it equal to truth? It is equal in the sense, number one, it points upwards. Number two, it's light. These are all things, you know, that I am giving you. They're not mentioned here. A third may be that it consumes or eats up evil. There are so many reasons. A fourth is that it symbolizes conscience, which is most important. Because no animal can ever light or put out a fire. It shies away from a fire. Only a human can symbolically light it and put it out when he behaves badly. These are all reasons that, you know, one can think of logically. But the important stanza where, sorry, 43.33.4, yeah, we'll come back to it in a minute. The important stanza which deals with, to answer your question last time, that Zoroaster was told to worship fire, if you remember, is 43.9201. Yeah, we'll come back to this. Spentam athva mazdam ingi aura, the same. This is in the questions he's asking. When good entered into, I asked, unto whom should I...